The beauty about algebra that we have experienced ourselves is that even when you don't intend connections, you know, the beauty of this entire exercise of meeting people who are at the cutting edge of their professions, who build a certain work ethic around it, is that connectivities build up almost automatically around them. And so our next speaker, who is one of the most popular, most successful directors in this country, someone whose hold on our imagination really is pan-Indian, and the numbers in his film show that. But really, the core concern of this director is also education. The nature of knowledge, the nature of freedom, personal choice, that has really underlaid Raju Hirani's personal journey and in many ways his cinema as well. What is fascinating about Raju is that it takes a certain kind of sensibility to push an entire society off its kind of central beliefs and yet not make them feel threatened when they are being pushed to the outer edges of thinking and of new kinds of imagination. Raju Hirani has mastered that art. In previous times when we've hosted him, we've said that he really has the art of chopping society gently. His friends who know him well say that in many ways what drives his gentle vision, these are words we use for him, but who is really driven by a sense of outrage, a sense of morality, a deep philosophical morality. And yet, what's beautiful about him is that the people he outrages against feel very welcome that they are being outraged against, and they tend to shift their perspective and shift their sensibilities. So he really is that fist in the velvet glove. Raju has just come fresh off another blockbuster. The beauty again of him is that all his films cross every kind of mathematical boundary. PK, I think, earned more than 700 crores. This one is well on to going beyond 300 crores. And yet this is a man who abhorred cost accountancy, who was terrified that he would one day become an accountant, and who really can't tell the difference between a credit or a debit. You know, he's just come back from Melbourne, where Sanju, with a white jury playing to white audiences, won the best film, the best director, and the best actor. It's also been shown in 65 countries. It was shown in Poland, and people across the world have been resonating with it, as they have with all of the earlier work of Raju Hirani, which was the two Munnabhais, PK, Three Idiots, and of course now Sanju. So the question we really want to pose to Raju today is that, how does he have the pulse of India? How does he read the Indian temperament, our emotional and moral temperament? And how does he translate that into cinema the way he does with that peculiar brand of Raju Hirani cinema? Before we call him onto stage, just a reminder of the kind of world he has created for us, a short film on his work. So, ladies and gentlemen, as I said, please welcome the director who knows how to chop us gently, Raju Hirani.
First, I should say that was very enlightening. And we all speak a language, but the way you put it across was absolutely marvelous. We realize the difference between animals and us today. Words. Thank you.
Thank you very much for being here, Raju. I'd just like to share with you that it's a particular privilege that Raju is here today, because both out of desire that this was the first edition in Chennai, and again a measure of what makes Raju very special is that we particularly wanted him here in Chennai, and he cut short his holiday in Australia to make it back in time to be part of Algebra's first edition. So do give him a long welcome. So Raju, let's start, as I said, not with Sanju, but with this idea that your cinema really, in a country that has very flourishing centers of cinema, Tamil Nadu has a massive industry, you know, there's a Telugu industry, there's a Bengali industry, and yet your brand of cinema actually cuts across India. For those who don't understand Hindi, your films have all of them been, redone in Tamil Nadu as Tamil films, and they've done very well. What is it that you understand about the Indian audience which seems to speak across geographies? You know, now that your films have done so well, do you yourself have an understanding of why?
I wish I had. I don't think there's any formula to cinema. you know, all of us make stories which we identify with, that goes out into the world, into the universe, and some of them will find resonance with the audience, certain kind of subjects. Certain subjects won't find a resonance. Like even when I look at my own work, I still feel Three Idiots found a lot of resonance with people because they could identify with the pressures of education. And that, till date, remains the most popular film. So I don't think there's any formula, and I don't think we should even attempt to create a formula. Like Abhijat and me, when we sit to write, the first thing we tell ourselves is that, let's make the film only for ourselves. Let's not think about the audience. Because the moment we start thinking about an audience, the audience is so varied across the planet that we will start thinking, okay, in Tamil Nadu, you know, somebody likes this kind of, say, this kind of action is very good here. It works here. In Bihar, somebody is liking this. Out in Australia, somebody likes that. So the moment you start putting in a film ingredients to please a different audience, you are assured of a mishmash. Then nobody will like your film. Possibly you won't like your own film. So at least when you do a film for yourself, even if the world doesn't like it, there'll be one person who likes it, that's yourself. So let's always do a film only for yourself. And you are an audience also. If you, while writing it, if you're laughing with it, if you're crying with it, then you can hope that the audience will also react the same way.
So I suppose what I was asking is that you do play, you know, although everyone now speaks of your cinema, there's a kind of phrase which is feel-good cinema. But actually each of your films have had a kind of underlying message, a kind of underlying issue that it is grappling with. And as I said, it does push perspectives. With PK, you took on one of the biggest things, which is the idea of faith and religion in India. With Three Idiots, it was the idea of education. With the Munnabhai, the first one was about you know, the ethics of the medical establishments. And yet you never seem to create offense in people, you know. So is that something that you set out to do, or is it just part of your temperament? Or are you actually mindful of not creating offense?
You know, I still can't analyze, because nobody does these things consciously. Actually, first time I'm trying to think about it like that. That do I? But I think all these things happen very subconsciously. If you believe something strongly, if you see, how do you write films? Actually, when you write, you are writing from your collective memory. Whatever you've experienced in life, whatever you've read, whatever you've heard from people, interactions. That's exactly what comes out in your scripts. So most films, barring PK, PK was a film where actually I wanted to say something about religion. Most other films I actually didn't set out to give a message. Like when we were writing Three Idiots, the idea was to create a world of a life in a hostel. I had lived in a hostel and I wanted to recreate that. But possibly inside us, there was this little outrage about the way education is. So that kind of crept in the script when he started writing it. So it's not a conscious effort to write in a way that there's a message, or write in a way that you're not going to make somebody unhappy.
So you mentioned about the fact that a lot of it is drawn from memory and from collective experience, but also your own experience. We were just talking with Professor Devi about the whole idea of education. You know, one of the big plot points in your life was your encounter with what was expected of you and how you broke free. Would you share that with the audience?
No, I completely identify with what sir said, because I think schools should be a place where you should be allowed to make mistakes. And unfortunately, schools are now a place where it's just a rush for grades. You're not allowed to make mistakes. How will you learn without making mistakes? And also the present model, I feel, the classroom model has to change. I once was in a small village in Wai, which is near Maharashtra, near Mahabaleshwar. And I happened to see a lecture. First of all, there were students which were from class 5th to 10th sitting in the same classroom. And there was an English professor who barely could speak one sentence in English. So I don't know whether this model should be existing, because now with somebody sitting in New York can actually teach English here with the current way It is. And I till date don't understand why I was taught that sine square plus cos square is equal to tan square. Why the hell did I learn trigonometry? I have no idea. I was just memorizing things just to pass through the exams. So I think education should be teaching you a way of living, not a way of, right now what has become, it's become like a way to make a living. It's not a way of living, it's a way to make a living, you know. Everybody looks for a course which will give them more money. So rather if we were taught the art of dealing with our own emotions, the art of negotiating, the art of dealing with human beings, rather than teach them a language, teach them a little bit of math, rest now, there are too many devices on your hand which will teach you whatever inspires you.
But what about that experience in your life, Raju, where you said that more than your marriage, more than your first film, than the idea of money, more than success, there was just one time in your life when you almost had a heart attack and died. You know, what?
Yeah, when I look back, actually nothing. My first film is, you know, all these are, you know, areas which have given you a little bit of stress. But when I look back, the maximum stress in my life was my 12th standard exam. There was not a single night I didn't wake up from my sleep thinking I failed. Every night I saw the dream, something catastrophic. Sometimes the earth is shattering and I was constantly worried about my dad is going to tell me, what my mom is going to tell me. That's been the most stressful thing. More than my marriage, more than my films, more than anything else.
You know, I'm really having to pull your teeth out of you today, Raju. That what was that particular episode where you wanted to change your career graph, and how did you come to become a director?
So the times we were growing up, actually everybody wanted to become either an engineer or a doctor, nothing else. So why? Nobody knew. So I didn't want to become a doctor, so I said, okay, let me become an engineer. So I joined. I was doing science till 12th. When the results came, the marks were not good enough for me to be an engineer. And the next option was, there was never big debates over it. There were not too many options. Next thing was to do BCom or do BA. So I joined BCom. So my uncle, who was a lawyer, he told me to become a chartered accountant. He said, you know, that's the next big thing which is happening, and so why don't you become a chartered accountant? So I joined this foundation course to appear for the entrance exam for that. Now I used to go for that class, and till date, actually, as you just pointed out, till date, I really don't understand between debit and credit. I actually just couldn't understand what is this accountancy and why am I supposed to do this, and I just couldn't. Now the exam was a week ahead, and I knew I'm going to flunk it. So my biggest worry was that now if I go to my dad and say, you know, I couldn't do engineering, I don't feel like doing that, I don't know what's going to happen. But I decided this is. So actually that scene which you saw in Three Idiots, where Madhavan goes to his father to say that I don't want to become an engineer because I'm going to make a terrible engineer, actually came from my life, where I had to really muster a lot of courage and go to my dad. You know, I still remember the place when I talk. I still remember exactly I was standing and talking to him. And I told him that, you know, I don't get this, so I don't want to appear for this exam. Fortunately for me, my dad was not the kind of father Madhavan had in the film. He just looked at me and he said, okay, if you don't like it, don't do it. What do you want to do? I said, I don't know, but I'll do anything. You know, I was willing to do anything. That day, if you told me to, you know, wash the whole house, sweep the whole house, I would have done it. So he said, okay, come and start working me. He used to sell office equipment, he used to sell typewriters, and had a typewriting institute. So next day onwards, college used to be just 3 hours in the morning, 7 to 10. From 10 to 6, I started sitting with him in the office, where I would go out and sell typewriters, calculators. And 6 onwards was my time. And because I think I had time, I discovered another world. I discovered this world of theater. So I started doing plays. I started writing for it. I started directing, acting in it. And again, I said I was fortunate enough to have a father sitting in Nagpur, coming from a very small, typical family, who said, you know, you are good at this. So why don't you go and learn this? So he was the one who actually told me, go to the Film Institute, learn this, and go. And when I went to the Film Institute, the same guy whose marks were so bad, I started getting a scholarship because I enjoyed what I was doing. So that's exactly what we tried to say in 3 Idiots, that choose a profession which gives you joy. If it gives you joy, then you will automatically excel in it. And that profession could mean anything. I've encountered one guy who actually cuts hair. You know, he's Ames, he chops Ames' hair. He's one of the finest hair designers. And he was an engineering student, I discovered, in my city. He said, he told his family that he's learning engineering, he hated it. And he shifted to Bombay, started working in a parlor. The family thought he was still studying there. They used to still send him money. And he used to love to cut hair. And today he's one of the finest. So he's enjoying what he's doing. He's successful in what he's doing. And he also, if people judge success with money, then he's also making more money than anybody else. So I think, what are we talking about? We're talking about education.
Education,
so
yes.
Coming to education, yeah. So chase what gives you joy, you will be successful.
You know, it's a measure of both Raju's father and really how long that journey was that took him to the Film Institute in Pune. Raju was telling me one day about an anecdote that the family milieu that he came from when he went to the Film Institute, some of his uncles and aunts would say, so does Hema Malini now have a new boyfriend? And he would be like, how am I supposed to know, you know? But that's what being in a Film Institute really was equivalent to. But of course, it opened up Raju's world. Raju, I'm going to come back later to ask you why and how being an editor, why it's so central to your cinema making and why you think that's one of the most important aspects of your craft. But before that, let's come to your most recent film, which is Sanju. You know, it's a film that has done tremendously well, but it's a departure from your work. It's a new kind of material to deal with. What particularly grabbed you about Sanju, Sanjay, that story? What did you find most difficult about doing that story? And maybe what is your biggest triumph in what you managed to pull off in that film?
See, as filmmakers, you're constantly looking for something which is unique. So all my films, I've always tried to say something, okay, this has not been done before. But that's not the only reason. When I heard this story of Sanjay Dutt, I thought it was pretty, I kind of connected with the father-son story, I connected with the friendship story. And so as a filmmaker, you are greedy for content. And you know, when you were writing fiction, you're starting from scratch. When I was writing PK, it just started from a germ of a thought that we wanted to talk about religion. There was nothing. And it's literally word by word you write, you say, okay, you create a character, okay, an alien, okay, let's get him there. What will the alien do in his search for God? How? So, you know, you're literally starting from scratch. But here, there was this man who was sitting as giving us anecdotes after anecdotes, anecdotes after anecdotes. So it was pure greed as a filmmaker where I thought, this is amazing. Whatever he's saying will make great scenes. So I plunged into it because of that. But it's not that I was very sure from day one that I wanted to do it. I needed to cross-check because you can't make a story based on what the subject is telling you. Sanjay Dutt can't be telling you that. So once I cross-checked it with various sources, then Abhijat and me felt like, okay, here's a different kind of a story. There's never been a biopic on the life of a Bollywood actor, and that too a living one. I can't think of any other biopic, and I can't think of anybody else who will have the courage actually to open out his life and say it so openly. So that was the primary reason. But in the journey, I realized biopic is a different kind of a monster. Because in fiction, you have the liberty to change what you want. If I don't like the ending, I'll say, I don't like the ending, let me change it. Like when we did PK, we shot the film. The original ending of PK was that Amir, who's the alien, goes away. And Anushka is sitting there, and she's very sad about the fact that he's gone away, and she's sharing this with Sushant, who was his boyfriend. The film used to end there. And whenever we showed the film in some test screenings, everybody said, it's too sad, we don't like, he should not leave. And this was consistently coming to us. So we actually went ahead and rewrote. So we said, he has to leave. The story doesn't end if he doesn't leave. But what I can do, I can get him back. So I actually took the shots from the beginning, those cloud traveling and that's space machine coming and opening and from the clouds. So I just put those shots back, wrote a voiceover, that he's coming back with his whole gang of people, and he's warning them, when you land on this planet, be careful about the human race, be careful about this thing. And when he lands, the clouds move, and instead of Amir, Ranbir used to step out. So there was a smile on the face, and he was warning them about how to deal with human beings and gods on this planet. So we had the liberty to change it the way we want. But with biopic, you can't change it. You know, if it, say Gandhi is a Gandhi, you can't say Gandhi was shot in the end. You say, no, it's a very sad ending. He survives the gunshot. You can't do that. So with this, I was constantly battling with how do you structure a story which is actually anecdotes. And also with Sanju, the biggest battle was that it's not a story of a hero. It's not a story of achiever. Most stories are about people who achieve something in life. Or at least they strive to achieve. They might succeed or fail. But there's a conflict through which they battle. But here is a story of man who has no ambition in life. Actually, the ambition is for the father and for the friend who are trying to get him out of this. So now, how do you make a story of a guy who doesn't want anything from life and still make it engaging enough for the people to watch? So these were the challenges which we discovered through the journey of the film. And I still see flaws in the film. I still feel it's not 100% there, because also you're trying to put in 50 years of somebody's life into those 2.5 hours. So there are battles, but finally, okay, I know a lot of people liked it, some people didn't like it. So you say, okay, you gave it your best shot. Now you move on to the next.
So speaking about the fact that some people didn't like it, unlike all your other films, which get a universal reception of happiness from every quarter, this film did get the media's back up a lot. You had a fair amount of critical reviews. The media felt that you had whitewashed the story of Sanju, that this was really a PR exercise for a friend, and all of that. So a lot of that allegations have come at you, Raju. So how do you respond to that?
Shoma, there are two kinds of viewers who go to a cinema hall to watch films. One are journalists, and rest of them are non-journalists.
Like animals and humans, you mean?
No, I'm not saying animals. Yeah, I respect journalists. But the difference
this is... This is what we meant about the fist in the velvet glove. I respect journalists.
No, I do respect journalists. There's a certain section I have a problem with. See, what happens when a common viewer goes to a film and he buys a ticket with his hard-earned money, he's going there to get entertained. He's with you. He's with the filmmaker. He wants to be entertained. He's saying, give me something good. Give me great 3 hours. And most time, we don't give them 3 hours. Then he abuses us. But when a journalist goes to watch a film, he goes to find flaws. You know, he's constantly saying, okay, now I have to write an article tomorrow, so I have to find flaws. With due respect to journalists, I'm again saying ki I do respect lots of journalists, but I have a problem with certain section. I guess you become good at what you do every day. You know, if you're a good person every day, you're good, you're humble, you'll become like that. But if your daily job is to find flaws, and more flaws, and more flaws, then you become so good at it, you're able to find flaws where they don't exist. So, I'll come
Raju,
to it.
Raju, you're giving me a great opening. Are you saying your film has no flaws?
No. I'm coming to it. Now I'm coming to it. There's a word which has been thrown in the universe called whitewash. You know, I've realized headlines work. And people don't... See, cinema is not people's life. People have a life. People go to work. Cinema is something they, in the passing, watch it. So there, nobody's really going and figuring out what happened. Nobody's got the time or the bandwidth to delve into, okay, what this film really said. So when you see a headline like Raju whitewashes Sanju, so that word sticks. So this has been asked. I've in fact been waiting for a long time. I'm glad you asked me this. At some point, I wanted the film to do its run, then wanted to answer this, and I will at some platform, but I'm glad you're asking this here. So I want to ask you. So you are a great journalist. I have nothing against you. But I want to ask you, or ask actually people out, other journalists, what have I whitewashed? Again, I'm not defending Sanjay Dutt at all. I'm defending my film. I say, what have I whitewashed? What was Sanju's crime? Can you tell me what was Sanju's crime? What is Sanju's general crime?
Well, the thing that he was finally indicted for was that he kept a gun.
Yeah. So he kept a gun. That's his crime. Have I shown that he didn't keep a gun? I've shown that he kept a gun. I've shown that he destroyed a gun. I've shown that he was arrested for keeping a gun, which he kept on saying, oh, I didn't keep. In fact, till date, Sanju had given a confession, and he retracted the confession. If you ask him till date, he says, no, I didn't have a gun. But I relied on the Supreme Court judgment, which said he had a gun, and he was convicted under the Arms Act, not under TAT. So I had to finally, when you're doing a biopic, you need to rely on some sources. So I took the Supreme Court judgment as the truth and said he had a gun. In the film, I've shown he does drugs. He goes to the pits. He does so much drugs that he actually picks up the pot and puts it on his fiance's neck, which he did in his real life. I've shown that he goes and sleeps with his best friend's girlfriend. Now, is this whitewashing? And why do I need to whitewash somebody? I can't spend 3 years of my life to whitewash somebody and in the process, you know, tarnish myself black. I'm not an out-of-work-up director. It's just that I've been fascinated with the story. And I thought that even from the story of a man with flaws, we might be able to learn something. And when I meet, not journalists, when I meet the real people, trust me, the kind of comments I get is, you know, I'll recount some of them. This one friend of mine who saw the film, this one friend of mine from Nagpur, who I show him every film because he's honest. Before he saw the film with his son, he called me the next day, he says, you know what? For the first time in my life, my son picked up my bags at the airport. He never does that. He said, Dad, let me pick it up. So I'm sure he saw something in the father-son relationship. He realized that what a father can do for his son. I met a girl who said, you know, I do drugs, I do intense drugs. And after seeing the film, I feel that I might be putting my family into so much of trouble after seeing the film. I think I should stop. I don't know whether she stopped or not, but at least the thought came into her head. So I'm saying even from the life of a flawed man, you can learn things. So I really don't think I whitewashed because you see so many flaws in the film, yeah. in the character of Sanjay Dutt.
Well, I don't want to bracket myself off from my fraternity, but I too found the word whitewash to be misplaced, but I did want to hear what you had to say against the accusations thrown at you. But a more interesting aspect of the film, Raju, and the reaction that it has got from the media is its criticism of the media in the first place. And at the end, you have this song, which is a kind of riff, a satire on the nature of media. Would you share with us, Raju, what about the profession today genuinely troubles you? Some years ago, Aamir Khan gave me a long interview about the state of the media, and he was very, very upfront about, you know, just the way that the profession is really killing itself. You do seem to have made an attempt to also show it up, yes, through the context of Sanjay Dutt's film, but the idea of the question mark that you put, this idea of blazoning certain words in the headlines, and nobody really does the due diligence. These are words that stick, and you may destroy people's lives, it doesn't matter. Have you had experience of that? Does it bother you in general? What do you have anxiety about the media? Do you regret putting that song finally because it got the media's back up?
No, I don't regret anything. I stand by the film completely. And this question mark thing is a bothersome thing because every day I see it about myself, you know. Somebody in Australia just pointed out, he says, you know, I hope you're not taking Ranbir as circuit. There was a news somewhere saying that Ranbir to play circuit with a question mark. So people don't see the question. That's a blind spot towards that question mark. People believe that. So every day, if I get me to tell you a funny thing, while I was doing the interviews during the promotion, before the release of the film, when nobody had seen the film, I was doing many interviews and one journalist did a whole piece, then he WhatsApped me the link of that, and the headline was Madhuri and some other actress, Raju spills all beans, question mark. And he had asked me that question, whether there's a reference to Madhuri or something. I said, no, that was the answer. So I saw that, I messaged him. I said, but I never spoke like this. He said, no, sir, you haven't spoken, so there's a question mark there. In the inside story, there's nothing. So this is just to get the people in. I don't know what happened when he saw the film. So there's this constant thing, and in Sanju's life, that's exactly what happened. The whole world, when I was doing this film, everybody said, but wasn't there an RDX truck in his house? And where did this come up? There's no accusation. Nobody has accused him of that. You look at his charge sheet. There's no witness who said it. No court which has charged him. No police guy has ever said there was an RDX drugs. So where did this come from? There was a media report with a question mark which said there was a truck parked in his house. So I think in this rush to be there, you know, you want to be the first one to break the news. So there's not enough research which has been done. And there are many assumptions. There are many, many assumptions. And sometimes, recently, a very senior journalist wrote something about me. He said, you know, they thanked Raj Thackeray in the credits and how Bollywood is scared of all these people. There are 10 other names who've been thanked, starting from Mr. Rahman, whose name was there, Mukesh Ambani, Priyanka, Jha. There are many other names, and there was one Raj Thackeray. So he says how they are scared, that's why they have to put in the name. And I felt that senior journalist, had my phone number. All it would have taken him was one phone call to check with me. So assumptions are made that why somebody's thanking somebody, or assumptions are made on everything, and stories are written. I think there has to be, as a journalist, there has to be some responsibility and some more credibility. Like nobody has, okay, let me tell you, nobody, not a single soul has written anything about this question mark in any story after the film. All they've said, because press has been criticized a little, so they've said, Raju puts all responsibility on the press. I've not put all responsibility on the press. Press is a part of the film. So at least there should be some introspection by a certain, there's a certain section of, like Abhijat said a great thing that day in Melbourne. He said, I'm a professor, and if somebody tells me there's mass copying happening in some place, so I won't say, no, mass copying is not possible. Why are you tarnishing the professors? I will say, yeah, it's wrong. It should be stopped. So at least somebody, one person should have written, yes, we use question marks to safeguard ourselves. A certain section of this thing is doing, that's wrong. Not a single article has been written about that.
No, I must say, Raju, that despite, as I said, coming from the fraternity, one can think of many, many stories, including what happened with Arushi Talwar's parents, with Binayak Sen, even with Shashi Tharoor, where there is an allegation, but there is absolutely no proof of murder, and yet the television crews have surrounded his house and, you know, almost played cops and robbers with arresting him, declaring that he's a murderer. So very often they don't even put a question mark and destroy people's lives. So I would say, for one, that the profession does have enough to introspect about
you. I'll tell you one more thing. This was after 3 days, there was a little controversy that happened with that film. So I was in my office and doing interviews in the morning. My wife called me up around 8 o'clock, yelling at me. And she said, what you're talking on TV is rubbish. So I said, I'm in the office, I'm not talking on TV. She said, but you're live on TV. She had called me in that little break. So I said, I'm not. So I put on the TV. I can't take a name because it's a very reputed channel. So on TV, I was in a window which said live. And that was recorded that morning. So obviously what was happening, the anchor was asking me some questions, which were the answers I had given, so he knew. Then somebody from the audience got up and asked me a question. So obviously I'm not there. So he's asking some question and I'm saying, all is well, all is well. So this guy started from the audience, got up and he says, what rubbish are you talking? And then the screen went blank and they say, Raju has got upset and he's left the studio. I have a recording of that in my office. We called those people the next day. Of course, they apologize. But finally, I don't know how many people saw the apology. It went on air. And so people who've seen me like that would always think, there's a stupid man. What stupid replies he's giving?
So Raju, let's move quickly a little bit away to, you know, your craft as a director. You have this principle of trying to make every scene almost in a film in itself, you know. We were talking about just the way that your films succeed. You have this LCD principle. Will you share with us what that principle is and how does that function? Give us some example of that.
LCD is a principle which Abhijat and me have kind of devised for own writing. LCD stands for laugh, cry, and drama. So we try and make sure that whatever we write, every scene should either have a laugh, or it should make you cry, or there should be enough drama to hold interest. Because what happens in cinema, unlike in books, we have to, there's a lot of exposition. Means you have to give a lot of information about a character, which in a book you can give it in a one line. You know, I can say, you know, this man is a very honest man. I can very easily say in one line, and the reader will say it's okay. But in cinema, you have to create scenes to prove that he's an honest man. So that's very boring. Exposition is very boring. So you have to find ways to hide exposition. And like to give you an example, if you remember Three Idiots, the first scene in Three Idiots is there's this plane going, and Madhavan is in the plane, and there's a phone call which comes. And he gets up, he gets a heart attack, he falls down. He's brought out, the aircraft has to make an emergency landing, he comes out. And then he opens his eyes, and then you realize he faked the heart attack, and he runs. Now, this is drama. Now, what happens with drama? It engages you. Originally, when I had written, we had written that he sits sleeping in his house, and he gets a phone call. And we see the guy who's making that call, and he says, you know what, I found Rancho. And he says, okay, I'm coming to meet. He gets up, goes to his friend, and both of them walk up to the water tank. Now, we wanted to make Rancho very, very important. So the moment you put this whole scene inside an aircraft where he fakes a heart attack, makes an emergency landing, I've not yet seen Rancho. But Rancho subconsciously becomes a very important person in my head. Who is this guy for whom this guy can bring a plane down? So otherwise, I have to say Rancho was an exceptional man who, you know, changed the lives of these two people in dialogues, and they'll be boring. So it's a ploy. We actually say it's a craft. It's not easy to do it all the time. You have to give a lot of information, but we constantly say, let's do LCD, that within every scene, try and actually create laugh, cry, or drama.
Yeah. So Raju, I want some LCD out of you right now for our audience. You know, you have this kind of ongoing battle with the idea of superstition. And again, it's particularly pertinent here because of what I was saying, that Professor Devi shifted from Gujarat to Karnataka in honor of Mr. Kalburgi, who was shot for trying to speak up for rationality, for a scientific temperament. Again, superstition. PK was all about that. But even in your personal life, the idea of blind faith really upsets you. You know, what is the origin of that? And is your war with religion just about the fact that it can create hatred, or does it go deeper than that?
See, I feel I do strongly feel about religion. I think because no religion actually teaches you to fight amongst each other. But unfortunately, the people who seem to be representatives of those religion tend to constantly say that my God is the best. And in that saying that my God is the best, that creates conflict. Yeah, that creates drama, as we LCD, that creates drama, conflict. And all the fight is about that. So, and then we want to protect a God, which is what we're trying to say in PK. You want to protect your God by saying, I want to protect my God, you're making God very small. First of all, we don't know. We don't even know who's our creator. I wonder actually, where did this whole concept of God came from? I think we're too small in the scheme of things to understand. And why this whole mystery about God? I said, why doesn't God just come up on, you know, in the sky one day, or just appears on the screen or on national TV at prime time and say, look, I'm God, and this is the way you're supposed to behave. Now, every religion tells me to behave in a different way. Somebody will have a concept of heaven and hell. One religion will have a concept of rebirth. Some religion will have a concept of karma. So there's no uniformity, actually. So there's no doubt that it's man-made. It's been made for a purpose. It's serving a purpose. You also need an anchor. It does help people in many ways. But it also does cause a lot of problems, actually. Our battles, our fights are because of religion. More people have died because of religious battles than anything else. I was in Auschwitz. I was in Poland and happened to see that concentration camp, and it is, I couldn't take it out of my head for a week that, you know, 1.6 million people were put into gas chambers. They wanted to wipe out a race for whatever issues. So I think religion causes more problems than benefits.
So in fact, Raju, there's this anecdote in your life when a particular cousin tried to convert you to Christianity.
God, how do you remember all this?
And you are really the plague of many priests, astrologers certainly. Astrologers have a supari out on Raju Hirani. You know?
I know.
So you have been the bane of many astrologers. Do share some stories. And also about this cousin who tried to convert you. Did he manage?
God, he'll kill me one day. So there's a cousin of mine who became a born-again Christian. And he was having trouble in his life, was not doing well, and he had issues, and was going from one temple to another, finally ended up in a church. He could identify with the teachings there, and his life actually changed. So we're very happy for him that it's changed, and it's good that he's come out of all his problems and doing well. So nobody was unhappy with that. But then he went to this extreme of trying to propagate and trying to convert people into born-again Christians. Because of him, and I actually love him, I like him, he's one of those cousins who you grow up admiring. So he used to be very frequently in Mumbai, and so whenever he used to come, he would come home with a Bible and with a priest, with the sole intention of converting me. So because of him, I ended up reading the Bible. First, I couldn't understand what it was. Then I got a what they call a good English Bible, which is the language you can understand. Then I made my notes. Then I used to wait for him, and we'd have many debates. So this is while I was doing Three Idiots, and I was extremely tied up. I had a shoot next day, and he called up. He says, "Hey, look, I'm in Bombay, and I'm coming home tomorrow." I said, "Yeah, please come, but don't come with any priest, because I actually don't have the time to be converted now. And I don't have any time for any debate now." She said, "Yeah, I know, I'm coming for breakfast," and I had to leave. So he landed up early morning with a priest. So we did the customary prayers before eating. And then the priest told me, "Look, son, I've just come to tell you that you have to follow the Ten Commandments. If you don't follow the Ten Commandments, when you die, there's going to be the Day of Judgment. And you will be asked by God that you didn't follow the commandments. So there's going to be hell, heaven, hell, hell for you." So by that time, trust me, I'm a good guy. I don't get angry very soon, but I think I had slightly snapped. I was in a rush. So with due dignity, but I asked the father, I said, "Father, tell me one thing. I grew up in Nagpur. From Nagpur, 200 kilometers, this Gadchiroli district is there where a lot of these tribals stay. I don't think they've ever heard about your Ten Commandments. I don't think they've ever heard about Jesus Christ. I don't think they've ever heard about Bible. For generations, they are being born, they die, they must be going up. So do you think God would be asking them and saying, 'Guys, did you follow the Ten Commandments? No? Go to hell.' Because do you think it's fair playing ground? In the first place, they should be told that you have to follow the Ten Commandments. So today, when I'm this old, you're coming and telling me, I didn't grow up knowing that I have to follow the Ten Commandments. I think what God should do is when a child is born, with the umbilical cord, there should be an instruction manual with the Ten Commandments on it, saying that, follow this. Now if, when you die, and if you have not followed it, then it's a fair playing ground that you didn't follow it. I told you. Now you, I must be 40 plus that time. I said, I'm meeting you at this age. I have born in a Hindu family. I've not been taught about this. I've been taught to do something else. Somebody born in a Muslim family is taught to do something else. So now don't impose this on me. I have nothing against you. So that was the last story I saw of the father and the cousin. I love him though.
Well, you know, as I said, we've run out of time, but just one last, because we are in Tamil Nadu, that when you were making PK again, you were doing research amongst astrologers. I'm sure, will you have the courage, people here who've consulted astrologers, will you put up your hand? I am doing that too. My friendship with Raju has survived that, but there seem to be many rational people here. But you know, how did you bust the astrologer's myth in Tamil Nadu?
See, I've spent my whole life actually meeting astrologers. You tell me there's a great astrologer, because every time I meet a person who says, you know, he told me things nobody knows, or he told my aunt, he told my uncle. So anybody who tells me that, I go to that astrologer. And in my journey, I figured out a lot of people still won't agree with me. I feel we tend to give them information. I think primary reason we go to astrologer, three. Either we go to an astrologer because we have a problem with money, we have a problem with our health, or we have a problem in a relationship. Now money could mean job and everything, relationships and... So astrologers are aware of this. That these guys have come for these... hardly any people go for entertainment. People like me go for entertainment. So, I'll tell you one episode, that thousands of episodes I can tell you, but one episode, this was again part of our PK research. I said, you know, like doctors, you know, people will tell you, okay, go to AIIMS, there's this one doctor who's very good with...
astrology.
Not astrology, with this. He's a good kidney doctor or he's a good lung doctor. So most people will have suggestions for that one doctor who's good. But in astrology, there's no one astrologer I've ever heard. One section of society will have this astrologer, this astrologer. So I still made an attempt to find out, I said, let's find out who's the best astrologer in Bombay. Everybody had different opinions. Finally, we picked one. And I wanted to go and meet him, but then I thought he'll recognize me. So I asked one of my assistants, who was a girl in the office, to fix an appointment. So she fixed an appointment. She gave her name. Then I told, no, you have to take Abhijat with you. Abhijat is a writer friend. So I said, he should go. So call him again saying, you're coming with Abhijat. So she called him again saying, I'm coming with somebody else. So he said, who is he? He's your friend or something like that. So this is the information I got. So I told Abhijat, Abhijat, the first thing he's going to ask you when you go with a young girl there, he's going to ask you that, he's going to say that you have a problem in your marriage. Abhijat went there. He looked at his horoscope. Actually, he took his date of birth, then he went to, nowadays they do it on the computers. He drew out one horoscope, then he washed it. Then he wrote something on a piece of paper and gave it to Abhijat, while Abhijat was sitting with that girl. Abhijat opened the paper and said, you're having a problem with your wife. So Abhijat said, no, I'm not having a problem with my wife. So he looked at him, he looked healthy enough. So he realized he's okay, there's no problem with his health. So he said, okay, I'll finish. He said, you're short of money. So he said, no, I'm okay with money. So he said, what do you do? He said, I'm a film writer. So he said, okay, what do you want to know? He said, I don't want to know, when will I write a film which will be very, very successful? So he looked at it. I think he had gone this was in 2010. So he said, you'll have a successful film in 2012. So, by the way, what have you written? So Abhijat said, I've written Lagero Munnabhai in 2006, which was pretty successful. So he said, but that money, he said, no, that money I invested into a house. He said, that's why it's not showing in your this thing. And he says, okay, now, will I write another successful film? And he said, it's going to be up in 2012. So he said, but I've written also Three Idiots in 2009. Then he shut his book and he says, you know, he called his wife. He said, my wife wants to see a shooting. Can you show him a shoot? Sorry, I can go on and on about this, but I guess we'll have to stop.
No, I'm so sorry, but we have run out of time. And as always, there's so much that one hasn't covered. Wanted to ask him about Ranbir Kapoor and Aamir Khan, about his craft as an editor, which he feels is the central gift of him being a director. And so much more, the kind of ethic that he brings to cinema making, because each film takes almost 3-4 years to create. But all of that, again, can be had over cocktails. Thank you very, very much for being here, Raju, for giving us a peek into your world.
Thank you. Thank you so much.